The Nigerian Economic Summit Group, in its role as connector, dialogue partner, watchdog, and intervener.
When you first start business, your target is to make your first million.
Seeks to change the narrative and trajectory of the Nigerian economy. Together with our partners, we're not just solving problems, but preventing them. Because when advocacy succeeds, the nation transforms for the better. But advocacy is for the strong. It takes fact-based inputs, resilience, partnerships, courage, and a lot of heroes. So be our hero. Subscribe to our channel, listen to our messages, and engage with us. Together, we can transform Nigerian lives, communities, and businesses. Welcome to the NESG Radio.
So Nigeria's socioeconomic indicators do not paint a good picture. We have high inflation, high unemployment rates, Naira is at an all-time low, insecurity is at an all-time high. Our Human Development Index ranking is 161 out of 189 countries. But as we have heard here today, we are Africa's most populous nation with the smartest people and the greatest resources. Research has shown a causal link between an effective public sector and economic development. Ndidi Umuneli spoke very eloquently earlier about the need for the public sector to create an enabling environment for the private sector to thrive. Right now, is our public sector optimized for growth? We keep reforming, but not progressing. Where are we going wrong? So this afternoon, we're going to discuss the role that the public sector plays in driving economic development. We will touch on previous reform efforts and interrogate the reasons for their failure. We will talk about the role that the private sector and citizens can play in pushing for reforms. Our panel, our distinguished panel here today, is made up of the head of the Civil Service of the Federation, Dr. Folash Adeyemi Esan, Dr. Joe Abba, Country Director of DAI International Development, Mrs. Nkem Ilo, the CEO of the Public and Private Development Center, and virtually we have joining us Dr. Adeyemi Dikpeolu, Special Advisor to the President on Economic Matters, and Mr. Olusegun Onigbinde, Director and Co-Founder of Budget. You are all very welcome. So I'm going to open up our discussions by giving each panelist 2 minutes to give your opening perspectives on the topic, and I will start with you, Dr. Yemi Esan. You're welcome.
Thank you very much, Afoy. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the opening statement might sound quite depressing, but I don't think that that is a position we should sit by and mope at. I think that the major reason we're here today is to ensure that the public sector and the private sector work very, very well together. Over the years, my experience is that the private sector sits on a very high horse, condemning everything the public sector is doing without really understanding what the public sector is all about. So I think that a better collaboration between the public sector and the private sector is what will bring us out of the very poor indices you reeled out. The public sector on its own part is trying very hard to meet the expectations of the citizens. But if the citizens do not come together and have the expectations written out, and there's an agreement between the citizens, the private sector, and the government. The government on its own part thinks we're doing very well, we're working very hard. And then the private sector says, we can't see what you're doing. So I think it's important for the two groups to sit down together, have an understanding. This is our expectations of the government. This is the way we want the government to work. And that way, you can now measure the output from the government to ensure that they are really doing what you want them to do.
Thank you very much, Dr. Esson. So basically, you're asking for more public sector, private sector collaboration and engagement. Dr. Abba.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'll spend my 2 minutes I'll spend the first 1.5 minutes, I think, by borrowing from the words of others, and then I'll say a few things for about 30 seconds. So in the beginning, 1959, I quote, "Our civil service is exceedingly efficient, absolutely incorruptible in its upper stratum, and utterly devoted and unstinting in the discharge of its many onerous duties. Our civil servants, government workers, and laborers bear uncomplainingly, without breaking down, the heavy and multifarious burdens with which we have, in the interests of the public, saddled them. And this is an epic of loyalty and devotion, of physical and mental endurance, and of a sense of mission on their part. From the bottom of my heart, I salute you all." Chief Obafemi Awolowo, 1959. Then we go to 1999. The world has witnessed a lot of changes since 1979, when I left office as head of state. Rather than being a source of innovation and productivity, our civil service and our public service has been turned into a haven for primitive accumulation and recycling of outdated ideas. One gets the impression that there is excessive bureaucratization or complication of simple procedures to inflict frustration, pain, and grinding poverty on people. The civil service needs to inspire hope, engender creativity, to serve as a model institution. Reform is imperative. President Olusegun Obasanjo, May 29, 1999. Let's move another 10 years after that. I quote, "Our public service has metamorphosed from a manageable, compact, focused, trained, skilled, and highly motivated body into an overbloated, lopsided, ill-equipped, poorly paid, rudderless institution, lacking in initiative and beset by loss of morale, arbitrariness, and corruption. National Strategy for Public Service Reforms, 2009. Let's go another 10 years, 2019. This is from the Federal Civil Service Reform Strategy. It talks about limited staff training, low evidence of the training that the training context is targeted and effective, no formal performance evaluation system, lack of performance measures, low adoption of digitalization. It goes on and on. So the question is, what went wrong between 1959 and now? Well, one of the things that happened to us is oil. We discovered oil. But we're not the only country that discovered oil. Canada has the third largest oil reserves in the country, has one of the best public services. We had military rule. And military rule is based on command and control rather than due process, which the public service is there to do. But Rwanda went through a similar civil war and has a really decent public service now. We had Udoji reforms that recommended a number of reforms as well as reality in terms of pay. Government took the pay one, forgot about all the other ones, about management by objectives and all those other things. And there was the Murtala Mohamed Purge of 1975, there are the Dotun Phillips reforms. The Obasanjo reforms, to my mind, started a bit late and suffered what I'll call infant mortality. We abandoned the merit principle in favor of patronage, and we've started to see the civil service and the public service not as a driver of growth, but as a necessary evil. So if our public service is going to get any better, the day to get better is the day the politicians decide that it should get better. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Dr. Abba. You basically gave us a summary of the way that the Nigerian civil service has deteriorated over the years. Mrs. Ilo. 2 minutes, please.
Thank you, moderator. My 2 minutes will be my take as a citizen of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. We've talked about the public expectation, having clear expectations from the public, what government should do, right? But if you look at Chapter 2 of the 1999 Constitution, the expectation is very clear. The primary purpose of government is security, bold, underlined, and welfare. I ask us as Nigerians, where are we when we come to security? Where are we when we come to welfare? I say this often to people around me. Myself and Kem Delim Ilo and my family, we've become a government. Why do I say this? The basic services of health and education, we provide. The cost of private education, we provide. The cost of electricity, energy, we provide. Solar panels, generators. The cost of water, we provide, boreholes. We have even gone to provide, road networks, contributing to our estates to get the estates connected to that main road. And we are sitting in Abuja, we're sitting in Lagos, we're sitting in Port Harcourt and talking about this. We're getting to the time of Christmas where we all redeploy from all of these areas to the rural areas. I'm sure some of us are already buying our drugs, buying all of those things we need to be able to have the basic comforts. In all of these times, Dr. Joe has just listed all the reforms. Reforms are in the air. But for the ordinary citizens, it has to translate to outcomes. Outcomes that improve our welfare. Outcomes that improve our socioeconomic well-being. You can't tell me that our budget has increased. We are increasing budget lines for security. We're increasing budget lines for education. When I still have to pay almost $500,000 to send one child to school for a session. That's my take, my 2 minutes point of view as a citizen of Nigeria. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Ilo. What you have basically said is that reforms are all well and good, but they need to translate to outcomes for the average citizen. So we'll go to Dr. Dikpeolu virtually. Dr. Dikpeolu, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you.
Please give us your 2 minutes perspectives.
Thank you very much. I thank you for the invitation to participate on this panel. I think those who have gone before me have really said a lot of interesting things. But I want to go back to basics. And the first basic is to say that both sides, public and private, need to have a clear understanding of what they expect from the public sector. So we expect the public sector, of course, to lead in terms of articulating our plans and visions. We also then expect them to implement. And the question is that, do they have those capacities? There's also the issue, of course, from this side of the public sector, whereby people are given positions of authority to regulate, and then rather than regulate, to support the private sector, in order that it can invest, create jobs, generate profits, and pay taxes. They see it at the first point in which, of course, to extract their own pound of flesh. Of course, again, we all expect the public sector to play a very important role in helping to coordinate policies across different departments and between the public and the private sectors. But then the point I really want to bring out is that I want to give a quote following from Dr. Abba. So I remember that was once in the era of structural adjustment. Someone asked the civil servant about their performance. And they said, you pretend to pay us and we pretend to work. In other words, the point really is that if you don't have market-driven pay, how do you expect high-level performance? And I think a very good example of this was Lee Kuan Yew in Singapore, who, of course, Singapore has the best regulatory environment in the world. He paid a great deal of attention to his public service, and he paid them the salaries commensurate up to today with that paid in the private sector. I remember that President Mandela, when he came to South Africa, was about to start off also. The first thing he said is that I've got to pay better civil service salaries. Otherwise, I'm going to give huge responsibilities to people that I'm paying peanuts to. So I think it's important as we talk about that, to be able to attract the best quality of people to the public service. We want a merit-driven public service, people who are highly trained. I remember in the era of the Western civil service that Dr. Joaba quoted, they used to send their public servants to Harvard. So I know that Professor Adedeji went to Harvard from the Western Region, Ambassador Shani went to Harvard, Dr. Ejiwere went to Harvard, all on the MPA program. So there's some light at the end of the tunnel. I know that the Aig-Imoukhuede Foundation is helping us also to send our young people to Oxford to go and do the MPP programs. So all hope is not lost, but I'm just saying that we have to contextualize, what do we expect from one another, and are we giving that support to ourselves to enable us to achieve the objectives that we want to achieve? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dufoyo. To summarize, you basically said that we need to ensure we have the right people in the civil service if we want it to be effective, and to do that, we have to pay them well. Mr. Sheo Onibinde, are you there? Can you give us your 2 minutes, please?
All right, I'm here. My name. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure being here today, and I'm glad to join you virtually. I think my own position would be about the size of funding. Also, talking about what Dr. Dupolu said, the size of funding that we have for the civil service in Nigeria, and the fact that that size of fund is not even enough to manage the civil service and put them in professionally. But we have had reports, and that has to do with streamlining the civil service and making adjustments so that we have a much more leaner service that's more efficient. I mean, there's the Oron Sai report. There's a report by Punch that says over 900 billion was allocated to agencies that the Oron Sai report requested for reform. What worries me about Nigeria is the pace of our reforms. We know what to do. We are aware of how we need to make changes and adjustment. But we choose not just to do it until maybe when our back is against the wall. We choose not to diversify our public revenues until oil revenues stop making sense or stop being enough for the size of our expenditure outlay. And the same thing we're doing when with the civil service. And if you look at the expenditure of government, apart from the debt service cost, there's inching upwards around 3.2 trillion. The next huge cost on the size of government is the civil service. And I always break that down. A chunk of that expenditure is defense, the police, the interior ministry, the education and the health sector. And those sectors deserve to be much more. We need to be paid much more. But the challenge I have is that we have a whole lot of places that we can make cuts and make adjustments so that we can give more to the sectors that are actually the basic principles or the basic ethos of government. And my own 2 minutes is just about, we need to push hard on civil service reforms. Now is the time that we do it, because the resources are actually no longer hard enough. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nikminde. You basically touched on the need for urgent reform. So I'm going to go straight to Dr. Abba and put my first question. So as former Director General of the Bureau of Public Service Reforms, you have been at the forefront of reforms. You referenced a number of reforms in your introductory speech that have taken place, that have been implemented. And as Mrs. Ilo said, they have not resulted in any outcomes. So can you please speak to the issues that have hampered previous reform efforts, and with specific reference to the Orosai report, what is happening with that?
I'll tell you what happened with the with the Orosai report. So the Orosai committee was commissioned in 2011. It produced its report in 2012. It took government 2 years to come up with a white paper. And that white paper said, okay, we like these ones we don't like. We accept these recommendations, we reject these other ones. The report actually has about 4 main parts, saying scrap some agencies, merge some agencies, stop funding some agencies, and change the laws of certain other agencies. So after the white paper was published, we were then preparing the 2015 budget. So I wrote to the secretary to the government of the Federation and said, here are all the agencies we said we will no longer fund. Can you please make sure they are not included in the budget for 2015? The SGF, to his credit, wrote to the Minister of Finance and said, this is what we promised in the white paper. So please do not include funding for these agencies in the 2015 budget. The Minister of Finance dutifully did not include those agencies in the 2015 budget. And then somebody realized, the government of the day is facing elections in the next few months. And so it was, we haven't decided to sack anybody, so we're just going to pay them salaries, but we won't give them any overhead. So you had public servants sitting around for 1 year, getting salaries basically for not doing anything. The new government came in with a promise, of course, to reduce the cost of governance, right-size government and all of that. A number of meetings were had. We briefed the president a couple of times. I was personally invited by the former chief of staff to the president on at least three occasions, talking about how determined the president was to make sure that this report is implemented. But let me just summarize it by saying that, having worked for Tony Blair, who had campaigned on a manifesto of public service reforms to come into government, I came into government researching the importance of political will. I left government after 4 years researching the concept of when political will is not enough. Because here was a president who had clearly expressed an intention to reduce the size of government, but then political will, believe it or not, is not limited to one person. The party needs to be interested. The cabinet needs to be interested. The public needs to be interested. And so when you just have even the president, as powerful as he is, if he doesn't have a constituency that can bring about those reforms, that political will, in truth, doesn't actually exist. That is exactly what's happened to the Orosanye report. We make every 6 months or so periodic announcements. Oh, the president has said go and implement. And then you hear nothing. And then 6 months later, there will be yet another announcement. That's why I started by saying the day our public services will work is the day our politicians want it to work. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that comment, Dr. Abba. What you have basically said, that political will is not enough. So as a populace, the private sector, citizens, we need to get engaged with government, which is what Dr. Yemi-Eson was referring to. So Mrs. Ilo, you are at the forefront of driving citizen engagement for the public sector. Can you speak to Dr. Abba's comments and talk about what you are doing in your work and the impact that has had?
Yes, Dr. Abba is very, very accurate when he talks about political will not being enough. And I will just give one instance before I continue with what we do. Nigeria has committed to fiscal governance reforms. Nigeria committed to the Open Government Partnership. I sit on that table as the incoming co-chair for the non-state actors. And that OGP framework is a platform that harnesses not just public sector, but citizens. It also brings private sector into the room. So it's a holistic platform that you would expect would accelerate the kinds of reforms we want to see. But then again, political will is not enough. It's not enough for the president to make that commitment at the London Anti-Corruption Summit, to come back and speak to the press and have that done. We still have heads of departments, heads of ministries that need to sit at that table and collaborate with private sector and the public. In the course of the work we do, we monitor health and education sector, right? It's around public procurement. We know that public procurement is the engine room for the budget expenditure. Half of, more than 90% of our money goes through the public procurement process. And it's very frustrating and disheartening when we see how much is committed in the budget. We see how much there's released through the Accountant General's office. And then you go to communities and you can barely speak to the provision of basic healthcare facilities, like the primary healthcare. We know a couple of years ago, His Excellency the President made a commitment, very strong commitment to basic healthcare, provision of primary healthcare centers in every ward. That's not happening. How many years down the line? It goes beyond the President's office to the ministries, to the departments, to the agencies, to those individuals who sit at the table that approve those contracts, that approve those processes. And you go to the site, you see that the contract says awarded, funds have been released, but nothing exists. That's what it speaks to. We talk about citizens' engagement. Citizens cannot engage without open accessibility to data, open accessibility to data that is useful, and an opportunity for a feedback mechanism. A lot of us here probably watch Big Brother Africa. We see what the cameras do. The cameras are everywhere, right? That's what the eyes of every citizen is. There are those cameras that are everywhere. But if you say citizens should participate, citizens should be involved, but you don't give an avenue for citizens to give you feedback on what they have seen in their communities, just think about one of those communities way inside one of the states. They don't have that opportunity to give that feedback and have that feedback work and bring results. You create a situation for erosion of trust. Nothing happens in Nigeria without a context. That's some of the issues we find. So we have this laudable big ideas, reforms. Take for instance, we're talking about performance evaluations for ministries, the departments and the agencies. That performance evaluation the expectation is that there is an accountability to citizens about what the ministries have determined to do, what their objectives are. That accountability for Nigeria has always been focused on corrupt practices, or we're trying to limit, plug financial leakages. But accountability is also the positive, right? Reinforcing public trust through disclosure of data that people are able to use and bring back to you and say, this is what I have found. How do we work together with the private sector? How do we work together with this ministry to make sure that our services are joined? And one more thing, I know I'm spending a bit of time, is that collaborative mechanism. Our structures are built to be silos. The Ministry of Works, the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Works, the Ministry of Housing, they are holding their information because each ministry is accountable. So there is an urge to protect themselves. But we forget that public services are collaborative. So I want to build a primary healthcare center in, let's say, Ogiri, in Enugu State. But there is a road that needs to connect to that public healthcare center. So the healthcare center exists, but whenever there is a flooding or we have heavy downpour, you find women, pregnant women, coming down from bikes 2 miles from the healthcare center, wading through the dirty, flooded water to get to that primary healthcare center. What's the value of the primary healthcare center if I am unable to access it as a pregnant woman? We need those collaborative mechanisms across MDAs, across agencies, and that's one of the things that I think will drive our reforms if we need to go to where we are going to. Thank you.
Dr. Yemi Esson, Mrs. Ilo posed a lot of questions that, as head of service, you should have answers to. So in your capacity as head of service, you must have come across some of these issues that she discussed, the silos, the lack of information. What are the reforms, what are the steps that you are taking to build a more effective civil service? And speaking to Dr. Abba's point, have you come against any resistance in terms of political will, and how are you working around that?
Yes. Before I talk about the reforms, I just want to go back to the collaborations I talked about, especially with the CSOs. If at the beginning of the day, the CSOs say that we want to see these data, please make your information available on your website, and these are the things we need to see. make sure your department gives us data on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 at the end of the day. Then that is collaboration. It's not that you'll go at the end of the day, you want to monitor, and then you're looking for data. And maybe the ministry, the ministry's program does not include some of the data you want. So at the beginning of the conversation, there must be an agreement that this is what we need from a particular MDA, so that that MDA can provide it. That is the first thing. The second thing is that the understanding of the structure that we run in Nigeria. We run a federal system. And so when we're talking about primary health care centers, what the federal government tries to do at that level is just intervention. You know, when the federal government sees that these things are not there, so they try to intervene. And most of the time, the intervention comes from a collaboration between the federal government and the state government. Where do you need these things? Where should we place these facilities? So, you know, that's why I said the understanding of how government works is key, you know, before we can now talk about accountability and what we're doing. Now, on the reforms, the Office of the Head of Service, since 2015 with this new administration, has been running the Federal Civil Service Strategy and Implementation Plan. We started with the first one, which ran from 2017 to 2020. And now there's a successor plan, which will run from 2021 to 2025. And most of these lessons, when we're developing the 2025 plan, for example, we sat down with civil society organizations and we said, tell us the kind of civil service you want to see. Tell us what we're doing wrong so that we can look inwards and try to correct ourselves. And we had, unfortunately, she wasn't there, but we had a very robust discussion. And we said, look, tell us if it is data you want, let us have the set of data you need. If it is efficiency, come out with details so that going forward we can include it in the plan. And so now this plan that we're working on, 2021 to 2025, has 6 major pillars. And like we've all said, the most important and number one pillar is capacity development and talent management. The service over the years has been known for capacity development. We've seen several cases where civil servants have been poached on because they're well trained and they move to the private sector because, of course, the pay in the public sector is not as good as that of the private sector. So those are the things we're still grappling with, because you train your civil servants very well and then they move to the private sector. Then you have to start all over again, you know, and the circle just continues. Once there's a public servant that is well-trained, the private sector pushes on them. The second thing we're working on now is the performance management, which she spoke about. Over the years, the old performance system that we've had is really not, I'll be very sincere with you, doesn't measure any kind of performance. And we've gotten feedbacks that this doesn't measure any kind of performance at all. That is why we're working on a new performance management system where every civil servant will get his own objectives, tasks, based on the objectives of his or her ministry. So you have the ministry's objectives, what the ministry wants to attain, and then your own tasks and objectives and targets now get from that MDA's objective. So you are measured on a monthly, on a quarterly basis. What have you been able to do concerning your own target to meet the overall objective? And we also will have a session where we talk about the resources. You know, everybody thinks that civil servants have everything they need to work with, but are not working. That is not the truth. You give somebody an assignment up. In the last 2 years, I've had to sometimes, you know, go and blackmail some of my friends just to get things to work with. Fortunately for us, the collaboration with Aig-Imoukhuede Foundation has helped the civil service a great deal, because the resources that the civil service does not have, the foundation is able to provide. So we're also looking out for the private sector to come and work with us in that way. I'll give a story. The first time we invited the chairman of the foundation to come and sit at an interview we were conducting for directors that wanted to become permanent secretaries. Initially, he didn't want to come, but I said, no, you need to come and see the quality of people that we still have in service. And so he said he was going to come. At the end of the promotion, our interview session, he came back to me and said, Madam, you still have a lot of good people in service. And I said, yes, they are there. But most of the time, they are incapacitated. There's nothing to work with. We're struggling with budgeting, just like every other MDA. The resources of government is limited, you know. So that is why we feel that the private sector should collaborate much more with the public sector. When you understand the issues that the public sector has, and in one way or the other, you can help the private sector or the public sector to develop, then the good goes round. But I can assure you that we still have very good, committed civil servants in the service today, and we're waiting for collaboration.
I will put this next question to you as well, Dr. Yemi-Eson. So, the Governance and Institutions Policy Commission of the NESG is focused on facilitating the overhaul of public institutions, strengthening partnerships with the private sector, and measuring government performance. So talking about providing access to information, one of the key outputs of the GIPC is going to be the Public Sector Performance Index. So how can you please speak to how that will allow the private sector, allow citizens to become more engaged with what is actually going on in the public sector? And also how, as co-chair public sector of the GIPC, you would like to encourage more private sector involvement with your activities in the civil service?
Civil service is actually very, very excited about the work the GIPC is doing. Because most of the time, the public sector is working, but there are no measurements, there are no agreed indices, there's no measurement. So we really don't know if we're doing well. We just wake up and we are always at the court of the press saying the public, maybe one public servant does something wrong, and then the reaction we get is that all civil servants, all public servants are corrupt, or, you know, so sometimes it gets depressing, and it discourages the civil servants that are actually hardworking. So this is a very, very welcome development. Honestly, we, in the Office of the Head of Service, we're very, very excited about it, because it's an opportunity to showcase what we're doing. And like I said before, the involvement of the private sector and the civil society organizations in coming up with the indices is key. You know, we need to have that broad perspective so that we know what the civil society organizations want to measure us on and what the private sector also wants to measure us on. And that way we can rearrange our priorities and make sure that we are able to deliver on those indices. So I think it's a very, very good thing. We're not shying away at all from it. We want actually to go full force with the performance index, and we're happy that GIPC is doing this. And we also are encouraging other, like I said before, other private organizations to please come and partner with the public sector. You know, once, most of the time they think that the private sector is so corrupt, they don't want to involve, but that is not true. I think Aig-Imoukhuede Foundation and will one day come and tell us all what the experience has been working with the public sector. I don't think it's as bad as everybody else wants to believe. So I think that that is actually a good starting point, and we encourage other private organizations to please join in and join forces with the public sector. The government alone cannot carry the load of what we are expecting. You know, the expectation of the public sector is quite high. And unfortunately for us now, the economic situation, the government cannot fund everything that we need to do. So we also need the private sector to come and join in and to see that we're not as greedy or as corrupt or as bad as people want to paint us to be. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yemeyason. I can personally attest from my work with your office and the office of the head of the civil service of the Federation to the integrity of all the permanent secretaries that I have personally engaged with. So I will put my next question to Mr. Sheo Nigminde virtually. So we talked about the proposed public sector performance index, and the head of service was quite optimistic as to how that would enable her office to better prioritize its work and its strategies. But you have experience with budget, and so has it all been positive? Trying to provide information to citizens, what has been the response from the public sector and also from citizens with having that access to that information?
Yeah, thank you so much. It's been a mixed situation. So we have some time, and it all depends on the individual most times. We've had some fortune working with maybe the budget office, the Ministry of Finance, and they provide such information for us. For example, a lot of people don't know that Nigeria's spending to some extent is made public, is on the opentreasury.gov.ng, and you can access it. The budget is on the budget office of the Federation, and so we just need more citizen actors doing the work beyond budget to make it more simple and more accessible, and we need more citizens more interested. It's just that most times when you bring up criticisms to government or you say things are not working right, it looks as if maybe you have a political coloration, or maybe possibly you don't understand that reforms takes time, or you're speaking in an idealistic sense. And unlike the title of this panel, it's called the urgency of now. We are running out of time. By the time you look at the way our phase two recessions in the last 5 years, we've had unemployment is rising and inflation is off the roof. The currency is losing value, it's insecurity. We're running out of time. And that's why the urgency is that broad forms of, you know, across the structure. Within fiscal reform, we can continue to run our tax architecture the way it is right. We can continue to have what we call the fragmentation of capital projects. We have over 11,000 capital projects in the federal government budget. Or why would you execute 11,000 projects in a single year? Why not just do 2,000 projects and be much more focused about how you put your resources in? There is still the politicization of everything that it must all go around, whereas we know that such systems are grossly inefficient. And so for us at budget, we want government to have, we've seen a bit of work around transparency. But we think with that, there's still a work that needs to be done. But where the missing link is accountability. There is still no structural way in which the government responds to people when issues of abuse of resources or under investment in capital sectors or even under delivery of projects gets to happen. I mean, and we see all of that. Schools not being built, hospitals not been up to date, and we're able to channel of that and we write the government. Nobody's even responsive to that. So what we advocate is a permanent responsive mechanism that government has, I mean, especially when it comes to budget spending, as much as possible. But like I said, we've had fortune of working with some great people in government, and we have also had misfortune, you know, of working with some few people, especially maybe most likely even in the National Assembly. But we count it that democracy is a journey, and we'll just keep moving gradually until we get to that destination.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nikinde. My next question is to Dr. Dikwe Olu. Are you there, sir?
Very much so.
Okay, so you heard all the different comments about trying to get the private sector more involved. You are in charge of the public-private partnerships in the GIPC. The head of service has indicated that she is very willing to work with private sector entities, to engage more with the private sector, to engage more with citizens. What are the steps that you think that the government can take to open up and basically create the accountability frameworks that will give the private sector and citizens more comfort in engaging with the public sector?
Thank you very much. Thank you. I think, first of all, I think when we're talking about accountability frameworks, I suspect that we're talking first, of course, about the use of authority for the purposes for which it is used. We're talking about the use of the resources for the purposes for which they are given. And we are, of course, also talking about ensuring credible commitments so that if you make promises, those promises are kept. I think in that regard, one of the ways that the private sector can help, and indeed civil society can also help, is to continue to actually maintain those pressures. If I may go into a bit of history again, I remember the United States Civil Service in the mid-19th century, I think it was hopeless, so to speak. It was just all the appointments were by patronage. They just appointed people to the civil service by patronage. But it was the pressure from civil society and the private sector at that time that led to what they called the Pendleton Act. And that act basically helped to create a civil service structure and to determine what positions required to be recruited by merit and things like that. So I'm saying first and foremost that the accountability framework will be very much helped by the private sector, public sector, actually demanding this, private sector, civil society, actually demanding these things of government. I think it's a good start. I think the other attempt, which is important, is the attempt to measure, to find out how are we doing against some of these basic metrics, which is why this the index that is being developed is very, very important, because then you have the benchmarks by which you can see whether you're making progress on critical areas relating to accountability. But mostly, and the head of service has made reference to this, there's the collaborative spirit, the spirit of saying we're in this together, the spirit of saying if we're in this together, by what means can I support you? Can I mentor some people, for instance? Can I post some people to the civil service to understand how it works? Can I provide some capacity to the civil service over the short run to help fill some gaps? In other words, collaborative, helping to sustain processes, understanding that there are challenges, there are revenue challenges, there are fiscal challenges, but willing to put some support in place. I think by and large, we should be able to get there.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dikwe-Olu. However, we are still faced with the issue of political will. So you can try to, you know, engage as many private sector entities as possible, have the discussions, open up your books, let people see, but the civil service is still overbloated. All the recommendations that Dr. Abba outlined have not yet taken place. So how do you work around that? How do you counter that? As head of service, what is it that you are trying to do to create a more effective service while dealing with political will?
political will is really not an insurmountable challenge. I think that it is just the will and the ability to be persistent is what is key. There's nobody that once you explain the issues surrounding a particular matter to, and you keep going back, you keep going, you will need to do this. We need to do this. I'm not giving up. I think sometimes it's easy for us to give up when we hit some roadblocks, but I've learned that being dogged and being persistent most of the time, sooner or later, all the politicians see the good in what we do. The Orosanye report that Dr. Abba was talking about, for example, when Mr. President said we should revisit the report, for example, and he gave the assignment to both the Office of the Head of Service and the Office of the Secretary to the government. The Office of the Head of Service looked at what the way forward should be. Because like you said, the report came out in 2012 and a lot had happened even after that report. So the recommendation from the Office of the Head of Service was that there should be two committees, one to look at what has happened even after the Orosanye committee, and then the second committee should now come out with an implementation strategy for the Orosanye committee. And I'm happy to say that with a lot of persistence, a lot of reminders, the two committees have started sitting now. And so it's not as fast as we thought it would be, but you know, we kept going back, reminding, we need to do this, we need to do this. And I also think that another thing that we need is when we're having, I was actually curious when I came in this morning to see how many members of the National Assembly were here. And I'm not sure, I wasn't here for the opening, but I don't know how many were invited and how many actually came. You know, this kind of discussions are key, you know, for the public sector especially, because as politicians, they need to understand how the system works. And it is just by engaging and engaging and engaging them, not giving up. Sometimes it might not be as fast as we want it to be, but if we keep at it, and we will definitely see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Dr. Abba, would you like to comment on that? Are you hopeful about the outcomes of the committee?
Oh, I'm always hopeful. it's in my nature to be hopeful, but I'm also quite realistic. To my knowledge, since 2015 that the current administration came in, the Bureau of Public Service Reforms has revised and updated the Orosanye report findings at least three times and submitted it to government. And so I'm very hopeful that this fourth time, something will actually happen. The reference made to the members of the National Assembly is also an important one. I wish they were here so that I could also tell them that you don't actually have to create a new agency for every new law you pass. At the time the Orosanye report was done, it enumerated 541 agencies. For the 2019 budget, we made provision for 1,100 federal bodies. That is a doubling within that period. We don't have a champion for public service reforms. I see Governor El-Rufai here. When he was in the federal government, he was actually the lead minister for public service reforms. We don't have that person. What we have instead is a Ministry of Police Affairs whose functions I clearly don't understand. Because we have an Inspector General of Police that doesn't report to a minister, reports direct to the president. We have a Ministry of Interior. We have the responsibility for the appointment, promotion, and discipline of the police is with the Police Service Commission. So I'd rather have a minister driving reforms than a minister of police affairs. I'm sorry if I appear to be picking on a particular minister. But the point is to show you that there are things to be done across the board, right? From the presidency to the cabinet to the National Assembly to the legislature to civil society organizations. We all just need to say, look, we want a better public service and it needs to start now. I think the if you look at what was achieved just between 2003 and 2007, it just shows you what is possible. Between that time, we now had an independent Federal Inland Revenue Service. We had the EFCC. We moved from a defined pension scheme to a contributory pension scheme, which meant that people at least can now get a pension, because before now, you were promised a pension. Whether you actually get it or not was another matter. But at least now with the contributory pension scheme, you can get that kind, you are assured of getting a pension. We have the reforms in the Federal Capital Territory Administration, which we're all aware of. We had reforms in our financial management systems, and all of that was largely achieved within 4 years. And people say, okay, the difficulty with implementing the Orosanye report is, oh, all of these agencies are set up by law, and so you need to go and change them individually by law. But the Petroleum Industries Act has shown that you can abolish 4 ministries with one act. So if you just bring forward a Public Service Act that says all of the following ministry agencies are now abolished, this agency and that agency is now, you just need one act. And so it is not enough that the president continues to make this announcement and make these charges. I lead an organization, and I know that if I ask for something to be done and it is not done, it is very, very clear to me what I need to do next. Thank you.
So, Dr. Abba, the gains that were made between 2003 and 2007, are you saying that they were made because you had a responsible minister for reforms, or there was more political will? What is the difference between now and then?
You had somebody who was responsible for driving the change. And then you had about 3 or 4 ministers. You had the Minister of Finance, you had the chairman of EFCC, you had the governor of the central bank, you had a few people who were like-minded about what needed to be done and who were seen to speak with the voice of the president. So you need that, and there's no country where you've had successful reforms where you didn't have at least one person sitting at the cabinet who was seen to speak with the voice of the president. So if you go to Malaysia, for instance, the person leading the reforms gets a report from every minister every Friday with which he goes to see the president. So if a minister is not doing anything, the president gets to know every Saturday, because everybody gives this report on Fridays. And so it was very, very good to see. I was fortunate to moderate a panel I think a couple of weeks ago, head of service, when the performance of ministers was being assessed, and Kim was also on the panel, and it was great to see that, because you know, in 2012 when we first did these ministerial performance scorecards, we came in 2013 to assess it, and all the ministers said, ah, we didn't know what we're signing then, no. We didn't really know that you come back and hold us to account for it. And by the way, you didn't release all the money you said, so how do you expect us to perform? So I was particularly pleased, actually, that ministers were giving accounts 2 weeks ago, and I hope that this can cascade into, you know, ministers holding PEMSEC to account, PEMSEC to directors, all the way down. That's when you have a meaningful performance system that is linked to what the government of the day wants to achieve.
Thank you very much to all the panelists. To sum up, we have tried to reform before, we are still trying, but the issue of political will is something that has to be addressed. It is important for the private sector and citizens to engage with the public sector and push for reforms. And most importantly, we need to appoint a minister of reforms, as recommended by Dr. Joaba. Thank you very much.
Thank you for listening to our content today. Remember to subscribe to the NESG Radio. Follow us across all social media channels and visit our website, www.nesgroup.org/NESG Radio. NESG, in the national interest.